Now we reach level 3. How can we recognize death? What is or what are the signs of death? That's the heart of the matter. Do we understand, do we know how body and soul are connected, united and interacting? Where is the basis of the soul in the body? Is there a special organ hosting the soul? Which organ is it? Or is there such an organ at all? René Descartes argued in 1649 that the pineal gland in the brain is the seat of the soul. But that could never be confirmed, and today nobody claims anymore to know the place where the soul can be found in the body. I think that John Paul II was right when he said that death results from the separation of the life principle or soul from the corporal reality of the person. The death of the person is an event which no scientific technique or empirical method can identify directly. When we can't identify directly the separation of the soul from the body, then we have to approach the problem indirectly. The soul is the life principle. So we have to draw the conclusion that the soul has left the body when there's no life in the body anymore. But the signs of life do not vanish instantly when a person dies. According to the tolerance of oxygen deficiency, the organs and tissues lose their functions one after one and not at the same time. It usually starts with the cells of the brain. After half an hour, the heart is damaged, then the lungs and the liver, kidneys, after some hours, the muscles, and later the bones. Due to specific circumstances, the cornea of the eye can keep its viability up to 3 days after cardiac arrest. And in the end, there's total decomposition of the body. And when does death occur? Do we have to wait for the last cell to die, to lose its function? I think no. We have to remember that we are not looking for the death of all cells of the human body, but for the death of the human being. So what could indirectly show us that the soul has been separated from the body? It is the disintegration of the body as a whole. That seems to be a plausible rationale for the loss of the life principle in the human body. But what signs indicate this disintegration of the body as a whole? Traditionally, we used to look for signs of death that can easily be observed or tested. An experience showed that there were reliable or definite signs of death and uncertain signs of death. The definite signs of death are decomposition, liver mortis, and rigor mortis. Other signs of death are unconsciousness, cardiac arrest, breathing, stop of breathing, motionlessness, loss of temperature, and paleness. But under certain circumstances, these conditions can be reversible or a function of the body can be replaced. Now let's have a look at the signs of death in the condition of brain death. First of all, there are no certain signs of death. No decomposition, no liver mortis, and no rigor mortis. And are there other uncertain signs of death? Yes, there is unconsciousness, but there is no cardiac arrest. There is no autonomous breathing and need for ventilation, but yes, there is oxygen exchange in the lungs, which means they are functioning. If you would ventilate a corpse, the lungs were only blown up, but the blood was not enriched with oxygen. That is a significant difference between a patient with the brain death syndrome and a real corpse. The patient is not able to move, but there are some spinal reflexes. And the body is warm, and there's no pale skin. All in all, the signs of death in brain death are not really convincing. On the other hand, we have many signs of life in a brain dead patient, as mentioned by others before. The heart is pumping, the blood is circulating, oxygen deficient blood is enriched in the lungs, nutrition is processed in the gastrointestinal tract, kidneys and liver are working, waste products are excreted, the immune system is working, there are spinal reflexes, the vegetative nervous system is working, hairs and nails are growing, wounds are healing, and finally, a pregnancy can be carried to term. In other words, the whole body is alive, minus the brain. The concept of brain death relies, in my opinion, on at least three reductions. The first reduction is to contend that there's only one integrating organ, the brain. As we have already seen, many organs and tissues are functioning, alive and interacting in a brain-dead body. And also the Pontifical Academy of Sciences, in its latest statement, has to admit quote, "The rare subjects who are brain dead but whose organs survive for weeks or months indicate that some organs, such as the kidney and the digestive system, can function independently of the brain, but whether they can integrate with each other is less clear," unquote. When something is not clear, there is at least a possibility. And it is perfectly not clear that there is no integration. And at the same page in this paper, we can read, "Whatever integrative subsystems the rest of the body may have, they are few, fragile, and poorly coordinated," unquote. I do not agree with this negative undertone in this statement, but it clearly says that there are integrative subsystems in the body. They may be few or fragile, but their existence cannot be denied. In fact, there is considerable integration in all brain-dead patients, especially in pregnant women. The second reduction, the Pontifical Academy's majority upholds as a valid criterion of death the irreversible cessation of all the vital activity of the brain, all the vital activity. Nevertheless, advocates of the brain death concept do not require that all cells of the brain must have lost their function. Only those parts of the brain that are tested by brain death protocol are considered to be relevant, and an EEG or MRT are not mandatory. The Academy tells us, quote, "There is no need for every single cell inside the cranium to be dead for the brain death to be confirmed."